You have just seen some footage of the Visual Arts Fest that took place at Bennett-Hemenway School on April 4th of this year. How did this wonderful celebration come about? I have here today the three women who are responsible for the idea and the carrying forth of this magnificent project. We have Elise Gephardt, who is very experienced in working with artists. You worked with the Poetry Alive people, didn't mm-hmm. you?
And the Author Fest.
Right.
And whatever. We enjoyed it. That's one of the interesting aspects of this. We enjoyed the success of both Poetry Alive and Author Fest, having performers come in or authors come into the individual classrooms and work with the students. And we thought that that sort of idea might roll over by using the visual arts theme. And that's really how we began.
That's great. And you're not currently on the Cultural Arts Committee, but you certainly are a experienced
right.
parent who mm-hmm. was very involved in the arts. And we have Judy Schreider, who is our library chairman, as well as a member of the Cultural Arts, and Ellen Bloomfields, and you're also the representative. Now, usually what the Cultural Arts Council does is brings in performances that the whole school sees. Thank you very much, applause, 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 and they're out the door.
Right.
And you wanted something different
right.
with this experience.
Right.
We wanted a more long-term experience, and we wanted each of the children to really feel very comfortable with the artists and to really get
a more hands-on experience.
And that's really what actually happened. The children all actually made something with their artists, and then we showcased it at the end of the Visual Arts Fest.
And if you just walked in and saw the showcase at the end, you wouldn't have had a real idea of all the work and all right. the hours that went in, even before the children and the materials and the ideas got together. How did you take the idea from visual arts
We really enjoyed the Author Fest idea, mm-hmm. and then we decided to sort of utilize that idea. And we researched it all summer with other communities that do a lot more with visual arts, and we had a whole list of names, and we interviewed artists. We then were looking for three criteria, really, when we were looking at artists. Artists that live locally, so that we wouldn't have to pay for any hotel accommodations, since it was a month-long project. We wanted artists that had good experience working with children, and we also wanted artists who were grant eligible, because we planned on applying for grants to offset some of the fees. And after we interviewed all of the artists and looked at their background, we really sat down with them and looked at the different grade levels curriculum, and from there we came up with a theme that the artists could work with, so that there was a real tie-in between curriculum and the project they were going to be doing.
Now, you had with the first grades, you had the different environments, mm-hmm. and how did that work in with the curriculum?
Do you want to speak about that?
Well, each first grade they chose a different animal environment. One was oceans, one was swamplands, one was desert, and one was the rainforest. And they did a month-long unit studying these areas through reading books, through visiting the library, reading about them. And then they individually had their own specific project to do, and then they combined it into these huge animal habitats.
Yeah. They were really great.
And so they worked alone, individually, and they worked together to make a big habitat to show all their, their studying.
And I think with Janice Levine is the artist, and she was used to working with younger children, so that she knew that she couldn't just work in one medium. She had to work in quite a few mediums just to keep their interest peaked the whole time. So some children work with papier-mâché, some children were working with clay, some were working with background materials, some were painting. And it was a very interesting experience, because they all worked on their own little parts of the major project, the desert or the rainforest or whatever their classroom project was. But each one then complemented each other as they put the thing together, and it was very interesting.
So it really joined the way that little children like to work individually, mm-hmm. and then with
yes.
the group
right.
as well. And then the second graders worked on their banners.
They did fabric banners with the fabric artist, Angela Kimberk, on the theme All About Me. And they studied the general community, the town of Natick, their homes, themselves, And they started out with a picture drawing where they placed their face, their idea of what they looked like, transferred it to fabric, and then surrounded it with their interests.
The stuff they liked.
Books, food, sports.
Yeah.
So that, which created a bright fabric banner.
Yeah. And then the third grade made those memory vessels that encompassed their lives.
Right. That tied into creative writing.
Right.
Where the third grade just starts to really do a lot of work in creative writing, and they were able to, on a piece of a papier-mâché memory vessel, which they blew up a balloon and covered it with papier-mâché, and then they covered it. It was basically a collage project of things in their lives, like greeting cards, ticket stubs, wrapping paper, old photographs of themselves, and they were, they papier-mâché'd it onto this big memory vessel, and then they wrote about it. So it really inspired them to write.
And through the whole project, it was interesting because some children preferred working with gooey, gunky things. Others wanted it nice and clean. Some children didn't want to get their hands dirty. But they all enjoyed each of the phases, and they loved their projects.
And the fourth grade did those stunning masks.
Mm-hmm. Which that ties was sort into of their international
and also multicultural and all that. They were just really mesmerizing.
Yes.
And it's interesting that none of the projects at all really featured traditional drawing.
Right.
They were all many different textures and mediums. Now, how did you get all these materials? Because the average school supply closet does not have all this stuff.
That was a problem.
Yeah.
Our school has them now, though. We really made a list with each artist and then went through what the school actually had. And a lot of the materials were recycled materials that were collected. A lot of the local stores in the community were very generous with either gift certificates or things that they donated, whether it be drop cloths, whether it be paintbrushes, scissors. We really were very fortunate in that. And then
a lot of parent donations.
Yeah.
Teachers sent home lists with the children, and a lot of parents sent in.
Now, what about the money? Where did all the money come from to do this?
Well, originally we had figured that it was going to cost us $3,200, and then the supplies would be on top of that, and we estimated those to be, we were hoping for under $1,000. We applied to the Mass Cultural Collaborative, which each of the artists was a part of. And we did receive $1,200 from that. And then the Natick Arts Council, which is the lottery money, they will be giving us $800 towards that. So that really we offset our costs quite a bit. And then with the companies donating a lot of the materials, or at least some money for the materials, we really were in good shape.
And while we were waiting for the grants, to hear if we had received the grants, our PTO covered us for anything that was not covered by the grants.
That's wonderful, working together. And then the actual workshops, when the artists came, it required teacher participation, the art teacher at Bennett-Hemenway, and parents that were in each classroom.
What we did was set up a volunteer network for each classroom with certain parents came in, certain days, and we always had a parent, at least one parent in each classroom to work with the teachers and us. And the
children. Well, we didn't want the teachers to be inundated with additional work or additional cleanup because the artists were only in the classroom for 45 minutes at a time. So that means really the setup had to be quick and the cleanup had to be quick so the teacher could get on with the rest of the day.
The artists were astounded by the parental support in our school.
The parents were really supportive of arts, and I think that message came across really loud
and
clear.
And the teachers also.
Right.
The teachers had to be very flexible. There were a lot of dates changed because of snow and illness, and the teachers were wonderful about helping out, giving an extra period, or doing whatever we needed.
And then we had at the end, the beginning of April, we had our Visual Arts Fest, which showcased all the children's works. And we did include the kindergarten because of the time restraints of the kindergarten day.
Right,
it wasn't really logical to bring an artist into their classroom. So what we did is we had a puppet show come in that was on an ocean theme, and that's the theme they were doing, and it was going whaling. And the children loved that, and then the art teacher, Miss Mateel, worked with them on finger puppets and sea monsters and things like that. So the kindergartners showcased their things also. And it really was a standing room only. Every parent was there, children were thrilled to, and they were thrilled to show their own work as well as to look at all the other students' work. It was wonderful.
Would you plan to do it again next year?
It's really, it demands
a
year-long
work. It's a lot of work.
Yeah. I think we would want to skip a few years and do something maybe even a little different. We really found out there's certainly a lot of creative spirit at Bennett-Hem.
There really is.
Yeah. And it certainly
And it ties in very well with all of the writing that they did this year.
So it's and we really feel that it pulled the school together. Yeah. We had such good feelings from all aspects of the school and the parents.
Yeah, the kids and the parents and the teachers and the artists. And it was very well attended. It was just a spectacular success. But it only came about through a lot of hard work, but a real dedication to the idea that arts are an important part of the curriculum. Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Art Paul Gosler. As a teenager, I've seen what drugs do to other kids. Not everyone takes it seriously, and that's why it's important for kids to participate in DARE, the Drug Abuse Resistance Education Program that's taught in schools across the country. DARE teaches kids how to say no to drugs, resist peer pressure, and build self-esteem. To find out how to start a DARE program in your school, call 1-800-TALK-KFC-DARE. Drugs are no laughing matter.
According to television research, viewers like you are attracted to babies, puppies, and the word free, which is why we're using them to draw your attention to the federal government's free consumer information catalog from, where else, Pueblo, Colorado. The catalog lists free and low-cost government publications on saving money, finding a job, educating your children, buying a home, getting federal benefits, staying healthy. Sorry, I thought I was losing you there for a second. Now, where were we? Best of all, the Consumer Information Catalog is free, and so are many of the publications listed inside. To get your free Consumer Information Catalog, send your name and address to Catalog, Pueblo, Colorado, 81009. That address again, Catalog, Pueblo, Colorado, 81009.
This is my memory vessel, and I Xeroxed the cover of my favorite book, Anne of Green Gables, and I put it on because I like that book very much. I put a lot of like flowers and decorations, bright things, because I like flowers in spring. I put a like American flag heart because I'm American, and I put a picture, a Xerox picture of me and my best friend Kane, and because I really like her, and I put a shamrock because I'm Irish. I put this first grade school picture because it's the funniest one I have. I put this fruit, this bright pepper, because I like peppers and I like bright things. And on the bottom here, I put a bunch of quilts, American flag quilts, because I'm American. And this is one of my favorite pictures of me at a baseball game, and then this is a picture of me when I'm a baby that I really like, so that's what I put on, and I like all the bright colors, so that's why I put it the way it is.
Yeah, well, on the first day, we blew up a balloon. Well, first, Carlin showed us snapshots of other memory vessels, and then we blew up a balloon, and we ripped up strips of newspaper, and we dipped it in paper mache, and we just smoothed off the extra paper mache, and we just rubbed it on the balloon, and then we waited it for it to dry. And then about 4 days later, 4 or 6 days later, we took a pin and we popped the balloon, and then we just made the bottom by rubbing water and just pushing it in.
Ow. Women can avoid two very serious birth defects simply by getting the right amount of a B vitamin called folic acid. If you're of childbearing age, start taking folic acid now. Ask your doctor or write to Shriners Hospitals for Crippled Children.
Millions worldwide depend on MedicAlert to provide life-saving information in an emergency. To learn more, ask your pharmacist or call 1-800-ID-ALERT. That's 1-800-ID-ALERT.
Kristen O'Neill from the second grade, and she's going to explain what it is she's holding.
They're all about me banners, all about us banners, and they show faces, they show you from your head to your shoulders, and then they show stuff that you like if you like to read, you would put a book. If you like a certain animal, you would make the animal, and they have your name on the back of them, and they're going to be on display tonight.
Thank you very much, Kristen.
Well, so you start out with paper, and then you make, like, paper stuff. Like, first you start out with your hair, then your eyes, and then your hobbies, and your shirt, and your hand. And then the next time you, there's, like, all different, she brings in all different cloth, and, there's certain piles of cloth. There's some for your hair and some for your eyes, and you have to trace it and then put it on. And you can pick any different type, and I picked this. And if you like hobbies, you can put like.
That's very good, Jill. Thank you.
Well, I. Some of my hobbies are reading, doing gymnastics, so I put one of the events, and playing soccer, and since I always wear a ponytail, I did the hair, and then a ponytail sticking up so you could tell that there was a ponytail, and I. I took a piece of cloth and I was tracing and I cut, and there's two squares when I cut, and so I figured that those could be my teeth.
Great.
Well, I like to play sports and all stuff like that, so I put like soccer here and football here and basketball here. And a baseball here, and I picked this color for my hair because it kind of looks like my hair, because my hair is like yellowish and like brownish and whitish.
Right.
Well, I started out with my hair, and I always wear a ponytail, so I put a ponytail and the bow, and I wear earrings, and I like to learn about space, so I put some space things, and I put a necklace to match my earrings, and an ice cream cone, because I like to eat ice cream cones, and that's it.
That's very good.
Okay. Well, here's a palm tree, since I kind of like tropical stuff, and I did, a skull and baseball bats, because I like to do baseball, and here's a football and a hockey stick, gonna hit a hockey puck.
This is Virginia Frymouth, the 1994 Massachusetts Teacher of the Year, art teacher from Duxbury, and passionate enthusiast for the arts and education. Virginia, what message would you like to give to the Natick community about your interest?
Well, I think that the arts are an extremely important and vital part of education for all children. Unlike some people believe, it's important that all children are having the experience in the arts. And it's also important for children to understand other peoples, other places, and other times. By studying the arts, it's a universal language, and it's a way for children to become familiar with their world. The arts really encourage children to work very actively in the classroom. It's an exciting way to learn. Art makes learning fun. And all children can succeed in the arts. It's a nice way not only to study a discipline in and of itself, that being art, but it is also a good way to use art to study other subjects. For example, children can learn how to do math using art, using visual pictures and symbols and images, as well as social studies and science, all different kinds of subjects. I would particularly like to congratulate the Bennett-Hemenway School here in Natick for their recent arts festival. I have been told about it. Sounds tremendously exciting. I think it's wonderful to have artists come into schools and have children see that the arts are, in fact, something that are done by real people and that they as well can enjoy in the experience of the arts. And I was particularly impressed by the way these artists and these teachers were able to bring art into the classroom experience and make that experience more meaningful for their children. Art, you know, creates a sense of persistence and patience in children. It also encourages creativity and imagination. And I would just say that in closing, for the 21st century, if there is anything that our children are really going to need, it is imagination and the ability to solve problems in their own way. And that's what the arts do extremely well.
Thank you so much. Bye.